everyone, and welcome to the latest edition of the Austrian AV Club, the podcast of the Ludwig von Mises Institute of Canada. I'm Redmond Weisenberger, founding director of the Mises Institute of Canada, and joining me today is Tom Woods of tomwoods.com. Welcome, Tom.
Thank you, Redmond. A pleasure.
Yeah, and I wanted to bring, I've always been a big fan of yours, Tom. Well, at least since I discovered the Austrian School, Mises.org, those sorts of things. And recently, I've really been enjoying listening to you on the Peter Schiff radio show. I'm a premium member of that. And one of the things I love is sort of when you're talking about American politics and one, you know, sort of obscure reference that you brought up a while ago was the McLaughlin Group. And how you used to watch that, or you still do watch the McLaughlin Group, right?
Not so much, but if I'm flipping channels and it's on, I am sometimes a little curious because I like the format and I like the fact that it's unrehearsed and unscripted and everybody can just go at each other. So it's the total opposite of watching a political debate.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. You know, I grew up, I grew up in Ottawa, so I was in the, you know, my father was in the civil service and my stepfather and stepmother are both American. And so we used to watch McLaughlin Group all the time. We used to watch Brinkley in the mornings. This was in the 80s, right? When, you know, sort of a Jack Germondo and, you know.
Mort Kondracki.
Mort Kondracki and these guys. And it was just, and like you said, it was just great because it's sort of a hilarious little, like I said, it's totally unrehearsed and they're just sort of entertaining this, I guess, this political theater kind of thing. But yeah, so how did you end up getting on the Schiff show? Like, where was that? Where did you do that?
Well, yeah, right. So Peter Schiff has a show Eastern time, 10 a.m. to noon, Monday through Friday. And you can, as a premium member, you get a lot of benefits, but anybody can listen to the show for free, subscription or not, while it's broadcasting. And then he loops the show over and over all day on the site for free of that day's show. And the way it happened basically was, I mean, I knew Peter already a little bit and we had interacted, had dinner here and there, or he endorsed a book or of mine or something like that. But I guess there was, and I need to acknowledge this on the air, I'm going to be hosting for quite a bit coming up relatively soon. And it was on the Ron Paul forums, ronpaulforums.com, I think, where they had some kind of poll that had come out from the Peter Schiff show saying Peter needs guest hosts to fill in when he's out of town and stuff. And, you know, we have a couple, but they're not always available. So they just asked people who would be your favorite. And I guess I won that just overwhelmingly. And I didn't know anything about this. I had no idea this was going on. All I know is that I got an email one day saying, how would you like to do this? And I thought I'd be an idiot not to do it. And so I've been doing it now for a little over a year here and there. And lately it's been much more frequent, and now that I've got basically a studio in my house, and you know the program doesn't have to pay a fortune to have me broadcasting from a radio station, it's all the easier. You know, at the last minute, they can just say, "Hey, you know, Peter's, you know, all of a sudden he's been called to Hawaii. He'd have to do the show at 3 o'clock in the morning local time. How do you feel about sitting in?"
Yeah. Oh yeah, and I find you have great guests. Like, it's a thoroughly interesting 2 hours that I get to listen to.
Thanks. I feel like it otherwise goes by too fast. I feel like I have more questions I want to ask these people, and the show's over.
Oh yeah, for sure. No, definitely. Like that's definitely the way I feel too. You know, like they're only on for 20 minutes, and that's the thing. You know, I'm doing these podcasts now, and I find I talk to guys for an hour, and it's not long enough. I could be, you know, sometimes I'll have podcasts with Jeff Tucker that go on for an hour and a half.
I have phone conversations with Jeff Tucker. Seem like they go on for like 4 hours.
Yeah, totally. So but I also want to touch on, because I know you've been doing you've been writing a lot of books on, you know, 10th Amendment and that sort of thing. But what I think is interesting, rolling back the federal government, but what I think is interesting about what you've really just launched is your online university, or what's your name for it?
Well, it's libertyclassroom.com. And the idea of it just occurred to me one day. I mean, in part, it was given to me by somebody, but I have a friend who has a great, he's just a great idea man. And he said, why don't you do this? Because I think a lot of us feel like the world is against us. There's nothing we can do about it. You know, the deck is stacked. Mm-hmm. The universities are against us. Everybody's against us. And man, it just stinks. And let's gripe and curse on Facebook about it. But then I thought, all right, well, but what if each of us in his own area of expertise, because there are a lot of things that I'm no good at, like pretty much 99% of things I'm no good at. And I'm not, that's not false modesty. Like I'm one of these people, I don't know how to change a tire. I'm not kidding. I have no idea. You got to call AAA. I don't know. I don't know how to change a tire. I can't fix my plumbing. I can't do any of these things. The only thing I can do is teach stuff. I can explain things so that people can understand it. Like I was the guy in high school who, when such and such basketball player was in danger of being disqualified from the team because of his grades, they would send that person to me. Teach this guy math. Save the team. And it would work. I would do it, and the guy would always say, you know, if only my teacher had explained it this way, I would have gotten it. So
Yeah,
I
sounds like
thought,
a bad 80s movie, but
yeah,
yeah.
I know it exactly, right? And then we become best buddies, the little diminutive me and the giant basketball player. Yeah, that part never actually panned out.
Brings you to the parties and all that kind of thing.
Well, but anyway, so what I decided to do was to try to change things a little bit by just saying, if the university is going to teach propaganda and the high school is going to teach propaganda, then you know, I'll just go online and teach the real thing. So I got together with a few other people I trust, other PhDs who are, you know, in short supply in terms of percentage of them that you can trust, but I got some that you can trust. And we put together this project whereby it's not delivered live. You can download the stuff that we're offering, US history, Western Civ, Austrian economics coming soon, more courses to be offered. Just put it on your iPod, watch it on your screen, do whatever you want with it. And it's just available anytime you want, but it's the real thing. It's the actual non-propaganda version. It's sort of the Austro-Jeffersonian version of all these things. And then if you have some question, you can ask any of us the question in our forums. We're going to have our first live stream session where you can have a live Q&A with us coming up in about a week or so. A lot of exciting things going on. It's just been absolutely great. And out of the gate, it's just growing by leaps and bounds. People are joining like crazy. And it's like less than one movie ticket a month, and you know it's incredible. This would cost you thousands of dollars in any other situation. And yeah, okay, it's true that you can go online, you can find some courses for free online. That's true, but okay, and they can be reliable in some areas. Sure, take a calculus course online, no problem. But with U.S. history, well, I'm not so sure you can rely on it. But also, can you ask those people questions? Are they you're getting recommended readings? You're getting all these other resources, other stuff added all the time, taught by people you can trust. I mean, really, we're practically giving this stuff away.
Yeah, well, I think what I'm quite interested in too is that, well, I mean, this is the problem through the sort of progressive era, you know, when you're looking back, the late 19th century, early 20th century, you really had the state took control of education, right? In mandatory junior school, grade school became mandatory high school. Became, basically we're in this situation where it's almost mandatory university. And when you actually even get there, I mean, what are you getting? You know, there was this idea that you're creating, sort of creating these citizens, who have a shared knowledge of the history, say, of the United States or something like that. But like you said, what are people getting? They're getting a lot of, as far as I can tell, sort of warmed over Marxism, this sort of, class analysis sort of view of history and whatnot. Certainly in Canada, I was just speaking with a guy who just did a talk on why Marxism, right? And he was discussing this, and he was talking about how when he was going to university, Queen's University here in Kingston in Ontario, the bookstore shelves are just filled with Marx. And when I read stuff online, like we have there's something known as the Canadian Encyclopedia. And when they sort of go into the women's movement, I'm reading this and I'm like, this is just Marxism.
Yeah.
You know, it's
Yeah,
it really is.
it's incredible. I mean, it goes to show, by the way, that it's like Hayek and Keynes, you know, where Hayek never really wrote the smashing refutation of Keynes, and it really would have saved us a lot of grief if he had done it. You know, if you don't really totally choke and strangle a fallacy, it will find its way back, as Keynesianism has started to do when we all thought it was dead 30 years ago, 40 years ago. Now it's coming back. Well, the same thing goes with Marxism. You can't just say, well, the Soviet Union failed, so that thing is gone and dead and buried forever. It has to be smashed on its own. It has to be smashed intellectually. So the next offering that I want to do, and I intend to do in the next few months on libertyclassroom.com, is I want to do a little, like maybe 12, 14 lecture course on Marxism, the system and its fallacies. So you just lay it out, you know, in a nonpartisan sort of way, without an axe to grind, lay out what he was saying fairly. And then just point by point, just take it apart. So it's just going to be a lot of fun to be able to get this off my chest. It's going to be great.
Yeah. Well, this is it. Is that you know, you can't, you know, you'll go to university for 4 years or even do a master's, a PhD, and you'll never get that discussion.
No,
right. And I
will
think
not.
It really is.
Yeah. And I could say I went through the most mainstream programs there are. I went through the most establishment programs there. I mean, people think of, I mean, I went to Harvard and Columbia. I got my PhD at Columbia. Now, people think of those as being left-wing schools. And I suppose from some standpoint they are. But in a way that kind of misses the point. I mean, Harvard is not there to foment social revolution. That's not what the elites want, right? They want to preserve the status quo. So really what you get is a very establishment status quo version of things. And I wouldn't say, and I have never said, that my history education at those universities was a waste of time or it was all propaganda or whatever. It wasn't. I learned an awful lot. I owe a tremendous amount to that. It wasn't so much that I was being lied to, although there were propagandists you learned to avoid, as much as it is that there were certain things that weren't talked about at all, certain areas of history that you just didn't hear about, like the stuff I've talked about in my book, Nullification. You don't hear any of that at Harvard. You're not going to anytime soon. So really what I'm aiming to do here is both inoculate people against the kind of storybook version of U.S. history that's based on all these great presidents without whom we'd all have perished, but also to provide them with the other stuff. Like, here's the other stuff that nobody talks about, or the questions that don't get raised, or, you know, the awkward silence. You know, we fill those awkward silences. You know, when you ask your professor a challenging question and, you know, he or she is looking up at the clock, like, when can I get out of here? And there's just this awkward silence. We fill those with the actual answers to your questions.
Yeah, for sure. And I mean, I was always a voracious reader, right? And my favorite classes were always history and these sorts of things, right? So, you know, like I was just able to gain that through my own exploration of knowledge and whatnot, right? And I often found, you know, like when I was, and I ended up going, when I finally got to, you know, sort of some sort of form of higher education, I actually did fine art, you know, and I strenuously avoided sort of all of the, I strenuously avoided anything to do with theory.
Right.
Postmodern. And in fact, it was, I picked up, in fact, I started my economics education, basically myself by picking up Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations in the year 2000, you know, I'd been hearing these things about capitalism and hearing these things about, you know, it had been 10 years since the Soviet Union had fell apart. And I was like, well, where am I going to start? And so I went back to the beginning. Well, as far as what I knew to be, you know, because when everybody hears about capitalism, they hear the, you know, Adam Smith, the Invisible Hand, these sorts of ideas. And I think that there's, and I almost think when it comes to economics, you know, when you're in high school, when you're in university, it is virtually impossible really to get economic education. You know, you might get some history in high school, but you don't get, at least I never got, and I never noticed, there's maybe a business class or an accounting class or something like that. But there's, you know, in terms of economics, you might get, you really do here in Canada as well, you get the sort of standard line that, well, there's a Great Depression, there was a New Deal, that fixed everything, and then there was World War II. You know, that's sort of what you get. And sometimes I think really the reason why they don't teach some of this stuff is they don't want to bring up too many questions. Either the teachers themselves don't know about it, or they don't want the kids really like, okay, well, this is the way our economy works. The central bank prints a bunch of money, and then the government spends it on whatever it wants, goes into massive amounts of debt, and raises your taxes through the roof. You know, like it's just...
Well, I mean, It's interesting that in those areas you talked about, you want to avoid theory entirely because you're going to be, it's just going to be absolute torture. But when it comes to economics, on the other hand, if you don't have the good theory and you haven't engaged with that, then you're going to be totally lost because, as Rothbard said, you're not going to derive an economic theory by staring at sheafs of statistics. What does that tell you? How do you know what's correlation? How do you know what's causation? You can't know that unless you have some theory. And so Krugman and Bob Murphy can both look at the same set of circumstances and each one feel vindicated and say, ah, well, of course, this goes to show Keynes was right. And the other one can say, this goes to show Keynes was an idiot. So at some level, you have to just think through each system logically. Which one seems to be describing reality better? I've basically been an Austrian since 1993 when I first went to the Mises Institute's Mises University summer program. And this is one of these things where I just became convinced of it right away and I just began to read constantly. But I had to focus most of my studies on history. That was my field. But I always found the time to read the economics. And I get people writing to me saying, I'm majoring in X, but I wish I knew more economics. That's too bad. I guess, just won't ever have the time. But you have to find the time, basically. And the way you do it is just become a very efficient time manager. Or every time I would walk across campus, whether it was, mainly at Columbia, when I would walk across campus, I would feel like, all right, I've got to make a 10-minute walk to my building and then another 10 minutes back. That's 20 minutes of time that I'll never get back. So I'm always going to have something playing in my ears. I'm going to be listening to something valuable. So whether it's the libertyclassroom.com stuff that we have or anything that you find online, put it on your iPod so that when you take that walk, you're not wasting that time. I mean, of course, once in a while, it's nice to just take a pleasant walk, and I suppose that's not really wasted. But if you're like me and you feel like I've got one lifetime to learn everything there is to know, then I don't have that kind of leisure time. You have to, one way or another, just bombard yourself with it or always have a book or a Kindle with you so that when you're getting that oil change, and you realize, oh, darn, I'm gonna be sitting here for an hour. I have nothing to do. Never, ever, ever be in that situation. Ever, ever. Or so that you wind up using your smartphone, using some app for an hour. No. Have an old-fashioned book with you at all times, and you'd be amazed at how much progress you make.
Yeah, I mean that was me. I mean, I was always the kind of kid who, I'd be walking home from school and I'd be reading a book, with the headphones on, hoping that I didn't get hit by a bus, like that kind of thing, right? And certainly, I mean, for the last since I sort of, once I found the Austrian School of Economics and Mises.org, I mean, it immediately clicked with me. I understood it and I realized like I've been an Austrian my whole life. And that's exactly what I did. I mean, when I'm washing the dishes, I just throw on my headphones. I'm pretty much listening to this stuff all the time. I've gone through probably every single lecture from, Mises University from, 2008, 2009, 2010. Joe Salerno and Peter Klein did that great lecture series on economics, a causal realist approach. But when you're talking about university level economics, because I a little while ago I went onto the U of T website and just said, okay, well, what would it entail to go back to school and check these things out? But the very, the problem I find with this sort of the modern economics at the university level is that I think they've got physics envy, which I think is, I believe, a term that sort of Joe Salerno has used before. So much of it is based on mathematics. Right, is creating these complex mathematical models. When I looked at the first year classes, it's like algebra and all these sorts of different mathematics classes, and I didn't sense that there was a lot of theory behind the economics that's being taught.
Well, this gets you into all kinds of questions of epistemology and how you really acquire knowledge, and particularly how you acquire it in economics. But what's revealing to me is what it has done in terms of a readership of the journals. Like, for example, the American Economic Review, there was a survey. This is the flagship journal of the profession. It's a survey done, I don't even remember how many years ago. How many people read the average article in the American Economic Review? And the answer, this is not a joke, the answer was 2.5 people read the typical article. So, I mean, at some point you have to say, you've hit a dead end. And it's not to say that there aren't some valuable insights that people outside the Austrian tradition might have. But I mean, we don't have to. I mean, I don't know anybody on the senior faculty of the Mises Institute who holds that position. There are people doing good economics in different marketplaces and sets of circumstances, but overall, when you read the whole non-caricatured Austrian package, my sense is that you're practically compelled to adopt it. It's tricky though, because we all sort of have an axe to grind, a preconceived axe to grind. We want the conclusions of our investigations to come out the way we want them to come out. And I think people who are, let's say, committed to a statist model and who are committed to a government intervention of one time or another are just going to tune out when they're exposed to Austrian economics. For example, Rothbard tells a story. Of course, we're talking about Murray Rothbard, who studied under Mises in his New York University seminar and was an incredibly prolific economist and scholar in his own right, of course. But Rothbard says that when he was teaching, he had his first position at a fairly obscure institution, Brooklyn Polytechnic Institute. He taught economics there, and I guess the faculty board or the administration asked him to deliver a plenary lecture to the institution about the subject of Austrian economics. Like, what is it that you do here? Like, we want to know what do you work on? Well, they all knew he was a laissez-faire guy. So when he got up there, he started to explain praxeology, which is the science of human action, basically examining, teasing out what are the implications of the fact that human beings have ends. We have goals we want to reach, and we have to employ means to achieve these ends, and every employment of means involves the action of preferring and setting aside, because I can do only one thing at once and only one thing with this set of resources. So if I do this, it means I prefer this to that. And we draw implications from that. That proves to us that there's such a thing as cost, because when I the concept of cost is implicated in the tied up in the concept of choice, because anytime I choose something, I'm implicitly setting aside something else. That's the thing I could have been doing. That's something else. If I hadn't done this, that's my cost. And on and on and on, you could just deduce all these important economic concepts. So Rothbard gets to step one in his university lecture on Austrian economics. Step one, human beings have goals. Human beings have ends in mind they want to pursue. He said, everybody's questioning me on this, trying to stop me and saying, no, human beings don't have goals. It's like they felt like as soon as they concede one of my arguments, then they have to accept Austrian economics and laissez-faire. So they had to stop me like right away. They wouldn't even let me get away with people have goals.
But yeah, and I think it's really important. I mean, we're sort of, I almost feel like we're reaching this point with the education system. And luckily we have the internet here. Because we've got this point now where people are going to school for, 4 years or so, and or even they go and get a master's, they end up with mountains of debt. And because the governments have been, interfering with the economy for so long, now we're reaching these points where, you've got a situation where, like, every kid in Spain has a university degree, every kid in Italy has a university degree, but 50% of them are unemployed. 50% of the kids under 25 are unemployed. And really, I see that sort of starting to come here. And I think long term, in the next 20 years, people are going to start to understand that it's not necessarily, you don't necessarily need a piece of paper from a, I don't know if this is what we're taught now, that you need in order to get to the next level in your career, in order to get a job, you need to get a BA, because that will prove in some way that you've jumped through the hoops. I mean, I don't even, when I went off to university, I even made it for my first year right after high school. I was standing up on my, I'm sort of like, I don't, I wasn't normal in this way, but I had the person read the description of what I was going to do. And I said, after jumping through the hoops of high school, I'm going to go jump through the hoops for 4 years at university, and
Yeah,
this is
well,
when I was
let me
like
jump in on
19.
this because I just read a very good piece, unfortunately, behind a membership wall on GaryNorth.com about exactly this subject, which he's very interested in. And he's pointing out, for one thing, there's this new institution, and I haven't investigated it myself, called New Charter University, where you can basically get a bachelor's degree accredited for about $8,000. And they've only got three degree programs, one of them is business. And so he says, if you go to this thing and you can place out of 2 years of it through the CLEP exams, at least in the US anyway. And so in 2 years, you can have your bachelor's degree and already be gainfully employed in some area by 19 or 20. And he says, now, okay, you don't have a super fancy degree, but think about what an employer is looking for. He's got that stack of applications. For one thing, a lot of employers feel are made to feel inferior by graduates of Ivy League institutions. They're not necessarily interested in that. What they want is a hardworking, loyal, smart, proven young guy or gal from some obscure university. I mean, that would make them perfectly happy. Because they, what are they looking through in that stack of papers? They're looking through a stack of people who took 4 years, in some cases 5 years, of burning through their parents' money, showed no initiative whatsoever in order to get a totally worthless liberal arts degree. From the point of view of the employer, that degree is totally worthless. Meanwhile, I've got this kid who figured out a way to get through college in 2 years. He supported himself while doing it. And in fact, while you're doing it, you offer, you go to a firm that's engaged in the type of work that you want to do someday, and you offer to work for them for minimum wage. You have no expenses. You're living at home. You work for minimum wage. They will gladly hire you for that. You get a lot of on-the-job experience. They know you're going to be loyal to the company. And so even if you wind up leaving that company after you graduate, the point is that your next employer is looking at your resume saying, wow, this guy's already got a couple years of experience, and he showed initiative, unlike these other bums in this pile. You're the employer. Which guy are you going to hire? And this guy saved hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Well, and that's the key, right? Like, I've noticed, because really, you know, if you want to look at from a real point of view, I mean, the purpose of university, the purpose of higher education was to become educated, you know, originally the idea was that you pursued it for its own end in itself. You know what I mean? And now it's almost become this, at least in Canada, for sure, we've got this situation where people, they just go because it's what you have to do after high school if you want to be able to be considered for a job. And I agree to some extent, but again, there's all these other things that get mixed in with it, like, well, we need to create a good educated workforce, and we need to create good educated citizens who can think about the ideas and understand the context. But oftentimes I find there people are just, you know, if I look at, you know, my younger sister, who just, she's about 25 or 24 now. And I just, I kept on hearing these stories of just, it's sort of this ridiculous, nobody's paying attention. Like, it just seems like such a joke. I mean, so many people have been forced into this system where you get all these people who, you know, absent this major pressure, pushing on people to go to higher education, they simply wouldn't have gone. They would have educated themselves in their own time. They would have gone into the workforce. They would have, you know, just gotten on with their lives. Instead, they get this 4-year chunk of time, you know, where it's just, you know, just wasted, essentially.
Yeah, and huge resources are used up, and then the opportunity cost involved. Now, it can make sense for some people, to be sure, but the point of my example is to show that it is possible to get through this sort of, to get an education inexpensively in a way that, even though you're not breaking the bank by going to Harvard, that you still can impress an employer just by how unusual your path was. Because remember, this employer probably has a family that's pressuring him to put his own son or daughter through, you know, Yale. And he's wondering to himself, do I want the kid to go to Yale and be brainwashed for 4 years and assaulted by the left constantly, and basically taught to question everything I taught this kid growing up? And then I'm stuck with a $200,000 bill for that privilege. And yet this kid who just walked into my door and handed me this resume has another idea, and I'm intrigued. So you're going to have to be creative in this world. You can't, in this economy, you can't just say, I'll just do things the way everybody else has been doing them for the past 20 years and cross my fingers. That option is closed.
Yeah, and it's interesting too, the past 40 years, you know, the whole post-war baby boomer, you know, they're the ones who really got this. This system was really built for them, I see. But, I think that's the only thing that people want. There's this sort of focus on accreditation now. And I think that's the only thing that's really stopping people in a real way from just going gangbusters into just complete online education, you know, that it's just, they want to make sure that they can get that accreditation.
Yeah, that is an issue, but it's going to be less of an issue because some of these institutions are going to go bankrupt, and
Yeah.
some entrepreneur will swoop in and buy them for pennies on the dollar, and in buying them, they're also buying the accreditation that comes with them. And then they've got their
Yeah.
foot in the door, and then they just have to hold
Yeah.
on to it from that point.
Oh yeah, for sure. And I think the internet has completely changed it, you know. Well, listen, I've got to go a little bit soon. I got to go make some lunch for my kids. Speaking of my kids who but I mean some of the classes that I'd like to see coming up, you know, I'm very interested in economic history as well. You know, because if you look at a lot of the books in you know, on the Mises.org and whatnot, you see people discussing, you know, what was going on during the Roman era, you know, in terms of economics and taxation and, you know, inflation, because we all know, you know, once you start digging into this a little bit, you start to understand that, you know, devaluation of currency is nothing new. You know, you start to understand that, you know, inflation of the money supply is nothing new. It's been done before. We're seeing it now. Nothing about today's world is unique, you know, and I mean, we're all human beings. And I'd like to get a sense. Do you think that you're going to be doing some classes on that, like looking at a, you know, the history of inflation
Yeah,
or something like that?
I have not ruled that out. I'm very interested in those things too. In the short run, I want to do things that are, in some ways, maybe more directly focused on current problems. I mean, right now, what we've got is, you know, we've got all of U.S. history we've covered, all of Western civilization covered. We've got Austrian economics, a full year's worth of material coming up in just a matter of a few weeks. But then after that, what I really want to do is a course on Keynes. The way I
Yes,
envision this course
absolutely.
is half the course is exposition of the Keynesian system. Because I think a lot of times people on our side don't really know what Keynes is saying. So when they go out and they try to do battle with Keynesians, they're frankly making fools of themselves half the time because they're preaching or they're putting into the mouths of the Keynesians ridiculously caricatured views that none of them hold. I mean, maybe your friend down the street who doesn't know any better holds, but no professor actually holds. So I want us to understand clearly this is what the other side is saying, and this is why they believe it, so that we know it as well as they know it. But then the second half of the course is now piece by piece, we're going to take this thing apart and show you where the errors are. So I think that would be so valuable. Keynes, the system, and the errors. That's what I want to do as my after. Austrian economics in general is done. The next assignment I want to give to my economics professor, who is that I have at libertyclassroom.com, is Jeff Herbiner, and he's already salivating at the prospect of getting this off his chest once and for all. The definitive smash of Keynes. I think that alone would be worth the price of admission to this site.
Oh yeah, well, you know, I'll tell you, I've already signed up for
Good
your
man, you are a model for all the human race, my friend.
I've already signed up and so I started listening to the first part of the Western history. I can't wait for the Austrian economics one to come
Oh, gonna be
forward.
great.
And I think that, and it's true. I mean, most people, what little, you know, economics I remember, and when you listen on the TV, you know, especially when I was growing up in the 1980s and 1990s, I mean, still, what little you got was essentially some sort of watered down Keynesianism, you know, government saves when the times are good and spends when the times are bad, you know, and that's sort of what, and I was, when I was running for city council, you know, I would run into people. This one woman on the street, and we were sort of discussing the ideas. She was some sort of political analyst, and then I started critiquing the Great Depression and the New Deal and FDR, and she was like, "No, FDR saved America." You know, there's just this craziness. But like you said, I think that there's a key here that there's so many fallacies that have been built up over the last 100 years. I mean, there's always been fallacies in economics, right? But there's been so many fallacies that have been built up over the 100 years. I think, you know, when you start to say, we've got a course that just smashes, sort of takes apart what has been done wrong over the last 100 years, I think it's going to be really highly desired. I mean, I know I'm very interested in understanding, you know, because the thing is, like you said, if you want to understand where you are today, where we are today, you have to understand what came in the past, what ideas informed the decisions that were made. And what, you know, what were the justifications for them, and moving forward, you know, how do we go forward in a correct way? And to that end, like, I'm right now working with Bob Murphy. We're working on putting together a documentary version of his book, The Great Depression and the New
Oh,
Deal, The
that's great.
Politically Incorrect Guide. Yeah, we're going to be launching it on Kickstarter or Indiegogo, and we're also going to be involving the people behind Prax Girl. So,
Great. Well, that's going to be a great project. I'll be glad to lend a hand in terms of promoting it.
yeah, totally. So again, I'd like to thank you very much, Tom, for taking the time to speak with me. I think that, anybody interested in real learning, in real education, in understanding things from a point of view that aren't necessarily, what you're sort of taught in the state monopoly education system, I think it's really important that they check out your website. What is it again? It's
It's libertyclassroom.com.
LibertyClassroom.com. So I'm gonna definitely be telling people will be able to hear about it, and I think it's important also. I mean, I'm here with the Mises Institute of Canada, but speaking as a Canadian, I know that so much of what we hear is really, so much of what we hear here about American, politics, American economics, American history really is just the mainline, elitist sort of view of what happened down there, like in terms of, when you look at the Civil War, what were the reasons around it, the role that FDR played, the role that Herbert Hoover played and whatnot. And then, of course, when we look at our own politics and our own history, we apply those lessons to what has happened here. And to some extent, like, I want to get this going in Canada, because so many people don't know even our own Canadian history. We essentially already have a 10th Amendment clause within our own constitution. It's called the notwithstanding clause. And provinces use it to shut down, federal initiatives all the time. Like, we have these sort of parallel things, and people will talk about, especially now that there's all this work is going being done in the United States with Ron Paul and these constitutional movements. Canadians sort of start to sometimes don't even realize that we have our own constitution that has its own particularities about, about how things should be run. And yeah, and certainly we'd love to get you up here sometime.
Oh, that'd be
I have a
great.
lot of people saying, hey, let's get Tom Woods up here. Let's get him talking. You've raised so many people's awareness about the true history of the last, 200 years or so.
Well, thanks. As my friend Kevin Gutzman says, have mouth, will travel. So, great.
And again, I encourage everybody to check you out on shiftradio.com. I love listening to you every day. I think certainly, I think you could even have your own show beyond that.
Well,
It's
at some point in the relatively near future, I will actually. We're just working out the details.
great. That's great to hear. Okay, so thanks again, Tom. And I hope we can talk to you again soon.
Thank you, Redmond.